When I'm up through the night, I can't turn down the noise, say all the words out of my mind. Welcome back to the interventions once again. It's been a while that I put up a new video. So this is actually a pre-recorded video from my presentation in ICRI session recently. So it's about chest lymph node irritation, and I hope it will be a great helpful thing for all of my viewers. Do continue watching the videos. Do subscribe to my channel. Help us cross the 1,000 mark and as soon as possible. So let's go into the video. And we do have an Instagram handle. We only share relevant cases, nothing other than that, in the Instagram handle. Please follow it if you like it. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you for your kind words, sir. Once again, I thank all the organizers of this wonderful program. And I'm very proud to be in this scenario now. And I would like to thank my teacher, Dr. Ganesh, of IJ Shetty Medical College, who had actually paved a way for me to do all these things. And all other members who had actually promoted me during this course of the time. So it's a hard, difficult times. The recent COVID scenario and all are very difficult for everyone. I hope all are doing well. And if not, hope everything will be okay soon. So myself, as R has described, I am Dr. Aris. So some of you might know me as The Interventionist channel. I have a YouTube channel, which is The Interventionist. So let's move ahead with today's topic. So today's topic would be a brief one. It's about thoracic lymph nodes, and basically it's about the nomenclature of thoracic lymph nodes. So we will start with a brief introduction like everything else. So we have multiple lymph nodal stations. So there are multiple types of classifications followed worldwide. So the most commonly and the most widely accepted classification is the one which is developed by International Association for Study of Lung Cancer, that is IASLC nodal map. It basically is a 14 numbered numerical map of the entire chest lymph nodes. There are old classifications still followed widely while reporting in general radiology, including me myself, sometimes or the most of the times, except for some cancer staging purpose, we generally use the anatomic location based classification. The others, the older classifications which now no longer be followed are the Mountain Dressler type, which was actually proposed and been extensively followed till 2009, this was proposed by AJCC. And we have the Naruke classification also. These are just for exam going postgraduates. If somebody asks you what were the older classification systems, these are the older classification system. Currently, the only classification system which is approved to use is IASLC nodal map. Okay. So before going in detail about any of the pathology, detail about the classification, we'll just briefly go about the embryological development of the lymphatic system. So lymphatic system development begins at the end of 5th week of embryogenesis. It is essentially around 2 weeks after the development of the cardiovascular system. So how the lymphatic system begins is, it begins as channels as a diverticula of the venous endothelium. So it has a close association with the venous channels when it develops. So these channels gives rise to 6 primary lymph sacs at the end of 6 to 9 weeks. And these lymph vessels grow out of the sacs along with the major veins. So most of these lymphatics are very closely related to the major veins. Okay, and in the lymph sacs, some of these lymph sacs will form a group of lymph nodes by the end of 12 weeks. A small portion of the lymph sac will give rise to cisterna chyli and thoracic duct. You know where it drains into. So eventually it will drain into the SVC. And we all know about that it is a right-sided one, and so far different studies have suggested that it is a 50-50 thing. Like 50% it will be on the right side and 50% it will be on the left side. It all depends upon the embryology. Even with a normal levocardiac situation heart, you can have either right or left opening. So then we have, so the important points in the embryology aspect is that starts at 5th week, the channels form sets 6 to 9 weeks, and almost the complete development by 12 weeks. Okay, we move ahead. So just briefly about the normal size, how we measure it. It is basically the old dictum followed is the short axis of less than 10 mm is like normal lymph node, but it is not always the same. In oncology scenario, you can get a malignant lymph node which has less than 10 mm short axis very often. And enlargement occurs mainly due to hyperplasia secondary to either inflammation or metastasis. Okay. So now to the classification system. So this is the IASLC mediastinal chest nodal map. So it looks very complex. You can see so much of numbers, right, left, 1R, 1L, 2R, up to 14. So it is very complicated right now. So I will try to simplify it for all of us to understand it better. So basic division, basically the classification has 14 stations, numerically tagged from 1 to 14. And it is divided into 7 zones. Additionally, there will be a add-on as R or L, R for right, L for left, and it is mainly for stations 1, 2, 4 and 10 to 14. Then we have an exclusive labeling of A and P, that is anterior and posterior, for station 3 alone. So now into details. So these are the lymph nodal zones. So first one is supraclavicular zone. Then we have the superior mediastinal lymph nodes or the upper zone nodes. Then we have the iotopulmonary zone. Then we have the subcarinal zone. Then we have the inferior mediastinal lymph nodes or the lower zone. Then we have hilar or the interlobar or peripheral zone. Both these zones are having extra mediastinal location that I will explain in detail while explaining them in specific slides. So this is the image representation. So zone 1, the supraclavicular zone. So it is otherwise also known as anatomic zone classification, is lower cervical, supraclavicular and sternal notch nodes are included in this particular group. So the essential landmark is the superior margin of the clavicle, superior medial margin of the clavicle and the superior margin of the manubrium sternum. So right and left are marked as the midline of that right and left are essentially marked according to the midline of the trachea. So you have on the right side of the trachea it is 1R, on the left it is 1L. So importance of supraclavicular zone lymph nodes is that if a lymph node is present in a case of either right or left sided carcinoma of lung, it is an N3 stage. So 1R and 1L with a lung mass is usually nodal 3 status, N3 status in TNM staging. So right this is an imaging representation of a right supraclavicular node. I have labeled it as 1R since it is on the right side of the trachea. So moving on to the next slide. So zone 2, the upper zone or superior mediastinal lymph nodes, we have total of 3 stations, that is station 2, 3 and station 4. So station 2 is upper paratracheal. So upper paratracheal lymph nodes are again divided into 2R and 2L. Here, but the division, as you can see, the nodes are almost coming to the center of the trachea. But the thing is that here the division is not the midline of the trachea. It is the left margin of the trachea. So remember that point when you are reporting it. If the lymph node is towards the lateral to the left margin of the trachea, then it is on towards the left side of the left margin of trachea, it can be labeled as 2L. When it is on the right side, even anteriorly, if it is crossing the anterior margin of the trachea, but it is still towards the right of the left margin, it has to be labeled as 2R. So this is an important point to note while you are reporting. So now the lower limit of the 2R, 2L in 2R lymph nodes is the innominate vein. And the station 3, the prevascular and the retrotracheal lymph nodes. we are divided into 3A and 3P. 3A stands for retrosternum and anterior to the vessels. So as you can see, whichever I have marked it here correctly. So this is a sternum, posterior to the sternum. It is 3A and it is anterior to the vasculature. And we have the 3P as retrotracheal station. Generally, the retrotracheal station knots are always seen towards the right side to the left border. So you should have ideally named it as right retrotracheal station, but we are not doing that. The importance of these 3A, 3P knots are that these knots are not accessible by, especially the 3P knots are not accessible by mediastinoscopy. You need to do an endoscopic ultrasound to access it. So these are the knots. So in a CT imaging, the landmark is the innominate vein. So above the innominate vein, you get on the right side, you get the 2R. And left side, you get the 2L. This is a left sided knot, 2L, very small one. This is a vessel. This is a very small knot here. Then we have anteriorly behind the sternum, you have the retrosternal knots. Then you want towards the seat, I've just put a line to show you the left margin of the trachea. And this lymph node is located to the left side. And so it is a 3A node located towards left side, so that's a left prevascular node. So generally we don't give it as a left or right notification in a 3A, third station of nodes. You can mention it as 3A and 3rd posterior, 3A and 3P. That's all. So then we have the station 4, which is lower paratracheal. Here again the landmark is the left lateral margin of the trachea. So nodes coming left to it, it will be marked as 4L, and right to it, it will be marked as 4R. So it is closely related to the 2R lymph node superiorly. The only landmark separating it is superiorly is the innominate vein, and inferiorly is the bifurcation of the trachea. Okay, it is noted as 4R and 4L nodes. So here I have drawn a diagram again to specify the side. So you can see this particular lymph node is almost into crossing the midline towards the right side, but even then also it is labeled as 4R. So these two lymph nodes are lower paratracheal lymph nodes or 4R nodes. You can see the SVC being marked here. Then comes the zone 3, the aortopulmonary zone lymph node, which basically has two stations. Zone 5, that is the subaortic or aortopulmonary window. Anatomically we still label it as aortopulmonary window nodes. Then we have the station 6, which is called paraaortic nodes. So paraaortic nodes are seen along the anterior and lateral infralateral to the arch of aorta and the ascending aorta as well. So the separation between 5 and 6 essentially is formed by the ligamentum arteriosum, which is very often not very well seen in our CT images because of the axial helical acquisition in HRCT. So in this image you can see that I have labeled ascending aorta, arch of aorta, and just below, just lateral to the arch of aorta is the paraaortic node. Okay, or the station 6 node, and below it, between the arch of aorta and the pulmonary trunk is here, pulmonary trunk and the left main pulmonary artery is yet to come up. So this very atypical looking node, it is a 5 node in the 5th station or the subaortic station, okay, in AP window, aortopulmonary window or station 5. So this is basically station 5 and this is station 6. Now coming to zone 4, that is the subcarinal zone, we have station 7 subcarinal zone nodes lie directly below the carina and between the main stem bronchi. So there is always a confusion regarding say station 7 and station 8 nodes. Till what extent it goes is, on the right side, you can take the landmark as the inferior margin of the intermediate bronchus. On the left side, you can take the origin of the left lower bronchus as the landmark for zone 7. So any node coming within this area, you can take it as subcarinal node. So this is the axial representation of the same. You can see already the bronchus have branched off. Okay. So this is a subcarinal node. You can see already right and left bronchus have branched off. And below, immediately below that, you get the subcarinal zone. I've intentionally kept the scano here to just to show you that the level where I've taken this. This is almost coming at the lower margin of the right intermediate bronchus. Okay. So next is zone 5 or lower zone or the inferior mediastinal zone. Inferior mediastinal zone, and here what we have is station 8 and station 9. Station 8 is paraesophageal nodes, which is essentially not surrounding the esophagus. It can be either anterior or right or left to the esophagus. Generally, we need label it as 8R and 8L, but it can be on both sides. So it extends down till the hiatus of diaphragm. So some very often you may get a lymph node very close to the hiatus, and you may get confused to name it which node. So see its relationship with the esophagus, and according to that, name it. Okay. And then we have station 9. It is a misnomer. It is not a ligament. Pulmonary ligament nodes. Basically, these are not true ligaments. It are just double reflections of the mediastinal pleura. So it somewhat comes on over this side towards the pleura on a lateral aspect. It will come. This is zone 9. Zone 9 lymph nodes are again named 9R and 9L. Divided as 9R and 9L. So this is an example for a 9L lymph node. So it's a left pulmonary ligament based lymph node on the lower aspect. So this is a 8L and 8R. The division is basically the midline of esophagus. If it is on the right side of the midline of esophagus, you give it as 8R. And if it is on the left side of esophagus, you give it as 8L. So I have marked the respective topo levels here. So you can see the difference in both. So this is at a higher level, and this is at a very lower level. Okay. So this just represents, the arrows just represents the level where it is on the right side and on the left side. So zone 6, the hilar zone or I plus the interlobar, and then we have the zone 7, peripheral zone, that both are actually extra mediastinal lymph nodes. And but it is located within the pulmonary visceral pleura. So zone 10 is hilar section, that is station 10 is hilar, station 11 is interlobar, and you have station 12 to 14 as peripheral. So station 10 is again divided into 10 right and 10 left. Then you have from 11 to 14, which is again divided into 11R and 11-14. So 11 is interlobar, just between the lobar bronchi, just beyond the bifurcation, that is between the upper lobe and intermediate bronchus on the right side. Then we have the upper lobe, middle lobe and lower lobe bronchus on the left side. Okay. So generally we may be able to trace the lymph nodes till the station 11, but after station 12 to 14, the lobar, segmental and subsegmental lymph nodes are very difficult to identify even in a very good scanner. Generally, we categorize based on the zone 10 and zone 11 nodes. So, just this is not a part of the anatomy here, but it is important in the basis of the clinical aspect of doing this particular type of staging. So, N1 to N3 staging. In the IASLC map, node map defines the boundary between the right and left paratracheal lymph nodes as a left lateral wall of trachea. So this creates some problems. There are some drawbacks to this classification. It essentially does not define clear landmarks for right and left nodes in three situations. One is in the prevascular nodes. Second is the retrotracheal nodes. And the third is a paraesophageal node. So I have already explained it earlier. As you can know, where the classification initially only marks for certain areas as right and left. So in so what we do for this situation right now is we take the midline of the trachea as a landmark for prevascular nodes and divide it into right and left, which I have showed you earlier, the prevascular nodes station. And in the preterotracheal station, that is essentially the 3P, 3 posterior one, we take the node as right-sided paratracheal node. And for the paraesophageal, that is the 8, level 8 nodes, we take the midline as esophagus as the landmark to divide it into 8 right and 8 left. You can do that. Okay. So this is outside the classification of IASSLC. They have not classified it accordingly. Okay. So this is essentially the N1, N2, N3 stage classification of right and left sided cancers. So this is available in radiographics. You can Google it and get the classification accordingly. You can see here, usually the 10 to 14 nodes on a right sided lung carcinoma is considered as N1. Meanwhile, the same, if it is present on the left side, that is 10 to 14 on the left side in a right lung carcinoma, it is N3. Similarly, presence of 1R, that is a supraclavicular node on the same side, is considered as stage 3 disease, and vice versa with left lung. You can go through this, and they have adequately named everything, how the classification has to be. So, to be precise, a positive right paratracheal lymph node in a patient with a left-sided lung cancer is classified as stage N3. And a positive left paratracheal lymph node in a patient with a left-sided lung cancer is classified as N2. This is a basic difference. So classification using IASSLC gives you a more accuracy to the report about metastatic staging in TNM criteria and putting accurate TNM criteria. So station 10 to 14 are in a right-sided CA lung is N1. Meanwhile, if it is left-sided CA lung, then 10 to 14 R is N3. That's just as I explained earlier. So this is the last slide. And basically, I want to give a revision for you, all who are watching. So identify the lymph node station from this image. I'll give a short time. Nobody can answer it, but you can just keep it in your mind. We'll discuss it. So here we have three important landmarks. One is the trachea is present. You can see the arch of the aorta. You can see some vessel here. This is an arterial phase, so this should be the right brachycephalic trunk. So basically, this is a lower paratracheal node. So this is a lower paratracheal node because it's already starting to bifurcate here. And it is seen at the level almost close to the lower margin of the arch of aorta, and you can see here this is a innominate vein, and you can see in the lateral image how big it is. So this is an atypically enlarged node along with other nodes also. There are so many other nodes in this area. You can this is a slightly obliquely occurred image so that I can show you multiple stations together. So this is actually a lower paratracheal node in the right side. So this is an atypical node which is seen in a patient with a lymphoma. So lymphoma cases are very good cases for you to learn about different stations in the same patient. You can take anywhere in the body and you can learn different nodal stations. Okay, thank you all for watching the program with me. And do follow me on the Instagram, and we have a YouTube channel which is The Interventionist. You can scan the QR code if you are interested in following the teachings there. Thank you.